have come together. This is a huge collaboration here between the Department of Biological Sciences, the CTE, the Department of Nursing, DOSE. We all got together and decided that we needed some information on the coronavirus. So we're going to have two different sessions. One, the first session from 12 to 12:30 will be from the Office of Public Health, which I also didn't mention, but Kathy was gracious enough to get us some of the Office of Public Health, because it's important to talk about that kind of information. And then from what I call the sciencey end of it, we'd like to have Dr. Morgan Pike, who is one of our virologists on campus, talk about what I call the sciencey end of it. But the biologists quickly correct me and say, no, that's the biology end of it. But so for those of us that are not biologists, we'll say the science end. But I hope that we give you some great information, and we'll try and put some time for questions in between. And thank you all for coming. So I'm going to introduce Rebecca Beeman. She is a hospital nurse coordinator for Region 6 for the Office of Public Health. And she's going to give a talk about the coronavirus as far as how it would affect you in the community and in your home and in school. There are some flyers hanging about. There's a one-page flyer if anybody needs one somewhere. And they're in the back if you can't find. So if y'all will give your attention now to Rebecca.
Okay, y'all just let me know if y'all have any trouble hearing me. I'm probably not. Dr. Holcomb was supposed to speak today. He's our regional medical director for the Central Louisiana of Office of Public Health. There are 9 public health regions in Louisiana. We consist of Region 6, which is Central Louisiana, which is the 8 parishes around that area. He actually got deployed to San Francisco just this past weekend to fight the efforts over there. He serves as a volunteer on a DMAT team, which is a disaster management action team. And we believe that he is helping those getting off the cruise ship over in San Francisco. So my particular job, I work on the emergency preparedness end. We have a program office. We fall under the Louisiana Department of Health, Office of Public Health. But we also, in the emergency preparedness section, our program office is called Bureau for Community Preparedness, which is in Baton Rouge. We're supposed to be able to respond to any all-hazard events. We mainly think of hurricanes. We think of disaster preparedness in Louisiana. So when the shelter over here at LSUA is activated, here they are taking care of the medical special needs patients and such. We have been on many conference calls. We take directives. The state is on conference calls with CDC pretty much on a daily basis. We have bi-weekly calls, just general information about the COVID virus. And we have just recently, especially this week, gotten out in the community and talking more about it. Because this is a new virus. Nothing was known of it until the first part of December. So there's a lot of information that's still evolving and changes every day. Information is updated. We get a lot of our stuff from the CDC, reputable websites, the WHO, World Health Organization, and the National Institutes of Health. So when people think of coronaviruses, they often call colds in the general community. There were 4 viruses circulating this past year. Most of them, I know, like a pediatrician, if they run that respiratory panel, they will show up some coronaviruses. There was some false information coming out about a month or so ago about local community members that tested positive for it. Well, this particular strand, and this, one of the reasons we're so concerned about it is there's no human immunity to this one yet since it's a new virus. And the generic respiratory panels that a lot of pediatricians and other providers were running has those other coronaviruses. And often it's just termed like causes a bad cold. This one, though, they're finding that the mortality rate is higher, especially for older individuals. And we'll talk more about that. So when we talk about coronaviruses, they are common in people of many different kinds of species, including camels, cattle, cats, and bats, which the last I've heard, they're thinking it's a bat in another animal reservoir that went over to the live animal market in Wuhan, China. This is where this really started back in December when they were getting reported. reports. Rarely these animal coronaviruses can infect people and they spread between people. You most often heard of this, like with MERS or SARS, and now this new virus. It's a beta coronavirus like MERS and SARS. All three of these viruses have the origin in bats. The sequences from U.S. patients are similar to the one that China initially posted, suggesting a likely single recent emergence of this virus from an animal reservoir. So with this one, transmission, it has become transmission person to person, potentially assimilating such as the annual influenza virus. I know with this one, there was a director from WHO, he was saying they're thinking this is less transmittable than the flu, but the mortality rate, when you consider the cases they have, is more fatal. Like it's like 2 to 3%, while the flu, even though in larger numbers, is like 0.1% for the fatality rate. And Dr. Cott may have, he probably has more statistics too, so he may so asymptomatic people means that they're not showing any symptoms, can possibly infect others when we talk about coronavirus, but it is unusual. So 80% of those confirmed with COVID-19, that's what they renamed it for the year, and it's coronavirus, they reported mild symptoms, most of them do, but there can be severe illness and death, especially for older individuals with chronic medical conditions. These are those, and we'll get to that too, those with lung, kidney, heart, diabetes, they're finding those who are 60 years and older are having really severe problems with this. Most often the symptoms are fever and cough. They're saying shortness of breath is kind of when they get to that stage where they need to go to the hospital. And what really is causing the fatalities in this is the pneumonias and the ARDS, which is acute respiratory distress syndrome. So that's when they're especially trying to say, if you have the shortness of breath and symptoms like that, that's when these people need to go to the hospital. So the incubation period is 5 days or as long as 14 days after possible exposure. And some of these slides, like I said, it's updated daily. There's no vaccine, although they are starting trials on some. My brother actually lives in Seattle, which is pretty hotbed for this now, and he was on the news up there, so I still follow the local news station, and they were asking for volunteers to test this vaccine. So they're getting that out. I know they shipped some to the National Institutes of Health. The last few weeks, I heard the 1st of April, they're really going to start testing to get a vaccine out there and have it approved. Commercial tests, which yesterday we got a health alert that Quest and LabCorp, and I probably have this on a later slide too, are now going to be able to test if a provider is unable to get someone tested through the state qualifications. So there are commercial labs that are going to start testing for the coronavirus. Because it was, you had to send it to the state lab had to turn around and send it to the CDC, and there was like a 4 or 5 day turnaround period. Now, the state lab, about a week and a half ago, we got the capability to test in state. So depending on transport and stuff, they can get a presumptive positive or a negative back within about 6 hours. Considering transport down there and then running the test. Yesterday there was a presumptive positive case, I'm sure y'all might have heard, it's a Jefferson Parish individual, and they're being treated in Orleans Parish. So it's presumptive positive, that means it came back positive in the state lab, so then they go ahead and they can start those infection control measures with this individual and find out this person's close contacts and start recommending that they self-quarantine also. They can't call it a true positive until the CDC test comes back, and that's looking at a couple days now to get that back from them. So in specific treatments, I did read antivirals, they're working on those also. The last I read, it was the same one they were trying to use with Ebola, but that has to be tested also. When they say antivirals, that's like Tamiflu, like if somebody has a flu and then there's another flu medication, it kind of, they can start that once they test positive, and you can kind of lessen and shorten the symptoms and severity. So they're working on an antiviral for that too. So the testing now, if someone comes in and presents with clinical features of fever or lower respiratory infection and a direct contact of a known positive case, I want you to go ahead and test. If there's clinical features such as fever, lower respiratory, requiring hospitalization, or travel to those countries that are listed as level 2 or 3, and I'll list, they'll be on another slide also. You want to go ahead and test. Also, clinical features, fever, severe, acute, lower respiratory issues requiring hospitalization, and there's no other diagnosis they can find. They were saying to go ahead and test those individuals. And it's normally the oral nasal swab, or if someone's like on a ventilator and stuff, because really that's the only supportive measures is stuff like that. Tylenol fever, or if somebody needs respiratory aid, they can do that. So some of those they're able to test on the lower respiratory system that way. And the last bullet point was what came out yesterday when I was talking about that Quest and LabCorp, the commercial labs, are going to be starting to test. So any FEBRA, which means fever illness compatible along the lines of COVID-19 that does not fit the state of Louisiana testing criteria, can seek this testing through these channels. And that's why you can go ahead and isolate them and treat them as a positive case. They still are wanting, because they're afraid that if these commercial labs start testing, they're still not keeping track of those numbers of positive cases. So you still want them to call this ID EPI number, this 800 number that I have here listed, and report any positive cases. So this is kind of more at a provider's discretion, like for priority testing. These are hospitalized patients who have the signs and symptoms compatible with COVID in order to make decisions related to infection control. Here's the adults that are greater or equal to 65 years old and patients with chronic medical conditions like I listed with the heart, kidney, lung disease, those who are immunocompromised, cancer patients, those with cystic fibrosis. And there has been reports that especially in China, it's not affecting kids so much. And it's kind of have people perplexed because they say coronaviruses normally affect children and adults the same way. But this one, those 15-year-olds and less are only accounting for 2.5% of the cases. And of those, only 2% are severe, have severe symptoms with it. And of that, only 0.2% are critical. So they're kind of, there's theories that they're bombarded, their little bodies are bombarded with coronaviruses all the time as a child, that there may be some cross-protection offered there, and that they have such a good immune response that they're not having the severe symptoms that they're seeing in the older population. Like I said, this is a new virus, and there's no immunity as of now for it. So, and then also healthcare personnel or other personnel that have contact with a suspect or lab confirmed case or history of travel within 14 days with signs and symptoms. So when we talk about close contact, it's defined as being approximately 6 feet from a case for a prolonged period of time, which is generally an hour or so. It can occur while caring for, living with, visiting, or sharing a healthcare waiting area with someone. It's also defined as having direct contact with infectious secretions. So that's why we're stressing, you know, going back to simple hygiene measures. Cover your cough and your sleeve, wash your hands for 20 seconds, sing the happy birthday song twice. Measures like that. Touch face, I know, eyes, nose, mouth. It's very hard. So I think we've all become more cognizant of it and aware that you. And we do touch our face a lot because this is spread through respiratory and they're also saying surfaces. But they're thinking it's not very hardy. A lot of basic chemicals will kill it, and I'll get to that on another slide. Let's see. And that say the contact occurs while not wearing the recommended PPE, gowns, gloves, certified N95 mask, eye protection, or that puts you at criteria for PUI, which is a person under investigation. So testing, we are encouraging everyone to call that 1-800 ID EPI number. That one is really more for medical providers, and it's available 24/7. I do sit at the office. We do have infection control people. She's the past 2 days. We have seen a huge insurgence of calls. Like they're calling the 800 number, and then they're kind of funneling down to the regional level. Most of them are just simple, basic questions and stuff. Some of them are facilities wondering about social distancing and stuff. So the testing medical provider determination in collaboration with OPH, IDF, and CDC. So stay testing, contact tracing will commence with presumptive positive results. So like this person in Jefferson Parish yesterday that tested positive, our counterparts down in the Baton Rouge region, which is region 2, should be going out there trying to find out who this person had contact with, prolonged contact, and trying to encourage those people to get tested if they have signs and symptoms and self-quarantine. Because I think that this, they can slow the spread of this. And I know that people, you know, it's just a bad cold, but there are individuals in public health, you know, you want to do the greater good for the greater amount of people. And since there are people who are dying from it, they want to try to negate this spread as much as they can. So CDC testing would determine whether or not we had a confirmed case, and that's where we're at with the one that the governor spoke about yesterday. He actually spoke about it before he opened his legislative session. But it's good that everybody is paying close attention to this. So these two numbers, the first one is the general information line for anybody out in the community, businesses, anybody concerned with having large gatherings. I haven't heard of many gatherings in our area being closed, but I know especially up in the Washington area, a lot of, or most of the cases have been, they're starting to tell people to remote from home, canceling a lot of large functions and stuff. So this one is open available business hours, and then the bottom number again is the ITFE number for medical providers that's available 24/7. So these are some statistics. Some of them are from the 6th. I did update the right-hand side yesterday, but I think that's even changed this morning. I heard that there were 750 cases nationwide with 26 deaths. Globally, 105,000 plus, mainland China, 80,000 total deaths, upwards of 3,000, and over half the countries are affected. And I think CDC may be slow because they were still reporting 19 as of yesterday, but maybe they're waiting on that confirmation test to get back before they consider in those cases, but that's what's being reported out by other news sources. So this talks about the travel notice. Those level 3, they're really recommended to avoid non-essential travel, especially those above 60 years old. Those are China, Iran, Italy, and South Korea. Those with level 2, which is just Japan as of now, they want you to practice enhanced precautions, and those in the higher risk categories may want to reevaluate travel to the country. Hong Kong is level 1, practice usual precautions, but you still want to do risk transmission activities if you can. So I heard today it was really all cruise ships, because cruise ships kind of seem to be the perfect incubator for all this stuff. You hear about these ships that have the norovirus, where everybody has the GI illness, with the vomiting and stuff. They're seeing this too on a lot with these ships. So, they're saying all travelers reconsider cruise ships or voyages into, this says Asia, but last I heard it was really any cruise during this time. And then I heard adults aged 60 and older try to limit any kind of exposure out and about in the public. Not to create alarm, but if there's ways you can do grocery pickup, or, you know, instead of sending several people to the store, you can send one person. Because I know my brother in Seattle, he said there was, you know, it was panic at Costco. I mean, toilet paper was just gone. And people were just really buying stuff up. So these are from current guidance for students and staff who recently returned from a place where COVID-19 is spreading. I know they had some students at LSU that Italy. Yesterday I heard that it was all of Italy they were trying to self-quarantine. It was northern Italy they were working on. Now it's really pretty much the whole country is on lockdown, and they're trying to do that. And students at LSU, they were just quarantining for 14 days. They recommend they take their temperature twice a day. If they notice the fever, you know, they're supposed to let IDFE or someone know. So you want to monitor current travel advisories, and that's kind of what I gave you with the level 1, 2, and 3 for travelers. It changes almost daily, so the recommendation should always be cross-checked. Current CDC guidance states that a traveler who returns from the level 3, but is asymptomatic, means not showing symptoms, to stay home and monitor their health for 14 days after returning. They should monitor their health with twice daily temperature checks and for respiratory symptoms. If they do develop a fever, you know, they should immediately notify the health care provider. And then it talks about Japan, level 2, same thing, monitor their health for 14 days. So this is steps that institutions of higher education should take now to prepare, which I know we have been. We've been sending Dr. Cormier, Dr. Correll information pretty much on a daily basis. I want you to stay informed of latest information through the CDC, establish relationship with partners in the community, which we are doing today. That's why I'm out here. Public health does kind of have the lead on this. We did a talk today at the hospital, Rapids Hospital, and as of yesterday at noon, they've closed some of their entryways so they can put a staff member there and ask if anybody's having symptoms, like there's any visitors. And actually today, I just got a sticker. All it has is the date on it. And I think they're going through a lot of these today. And I know they said it was kind of bottlenecking a little bit in the ER because there's so many visitors to that. But it's a good way for our business to protect themselves. Because as you know, the Life Care Center in Kent, Washington, had a lot of sick individuals who were really affected by the spread of this disease. So when I presented this morning, we went through there at the talk, there was an employee there. She just asked, was I having any symptoms, cough, fever, did I have any recent travel? So we made our parts happy because, you know, if preparing now for this kind of event or, you know, any kind of pandemic, but we're kind of treating this as we would for pandemic flu claims and stuff because it's still a severe respiratory illness transmission. So they just started that yesterday at noon. So you want to review emergency plans for your agency, develop communication plans for your agency with key partners. You want to monitor and plan for absenteeism. So this is somebody sick, you really want them to stay at home. So asking businesses and stuff to be more flexible with that. I know some school systems, those who can't do online learning, some of the primary elementaries and stuff, or getting packets together, I know especially in the Washington area for their students who don't have online availability, just to, if schools are closed, they'll have that information and continue the educational learning that way. So you want to establish procedures for students, staff, and faculty who are sick on campus, perform routine environmental cleaning, and I'll talk a little bit more on another slide, and review CDC's guidance for businesses and employers. The website has for faith-based organizations, for family emergency planning, healthcare, law enforcement, first responders. They have a little protocol for each group, pretty much, on their website that anyone wants to pull and share that with anyone. So you want to communicate with your staff and workforce, provide information on prevention and how to protect themselves and their families, and communicate with their patients. So, ensure proper use of PPE and conduct, which is personal protective equipment, and conduct regular inventories of PPE. And I'll talk about that again in a minute because there's been such a high demand. Lowe's, Home Depot, they said they can't keep masks in stock because people are buying that up. You want to encourage hand washing, covering your cough or sneeze, and or use of a hand sanitizer if hand washing is available. So you want to use, which most of them are, 60% alcohol-based or more, and decrease the hand-to-face contact. So the Surgeon General, I thought this was neat, he posted this on Twitter the other day. So he posted, surgical masks don't provide you respiratory protection against diseases. They protect others from your cough. So it's really the patient having symptoms that kind of, it prevents them from spreading it. So we look at two of the masks that have been talked about a lot. Surgical mask and the N95 respirator. The surgical mask, they say, can be loose. Kind of once it gets wet, it's not as effective. It's still better to use that than nothing, but it's mainly for the patient experience and symptoms. So I know at our health units, we have a box up front, and we kind of do this every flu season. Like if someone's having symptoms, we offer them to put on a mask. Now the N95 respirator, which most of us haven't heard of until this, it's more tight fitting, but then again, it's people are more apt to touch their face when they have it on, and you're really supposed to be fit tested for the N95, especially for those, because they, a lot of hospital workers, when they do put somebody in respiratory isolation, they wear these N95s, like people with suspected TB, but the employee is really supposed to be fit tested for it to fit appropriately. So again, if you're sick, stay home, rest, and remember, cover your cough and sneezes with a tissue, wash your hands, often with soap and water, and talk to your supervisor about working from home. If you want to protect your patients, stay up to date on information concerning the virus, screen patients, ask the questions, separate those who are having symptoms, social distancing, consider strategies to prevent patients who can care from home, like coming to a facility, telephone systems to deliver messages, adjusting your hours of operation, leveraging telemedicine technologies and self-assessment tools. I know they have, in New York, they had someone that rode the subway every day, so they're trying to clean them more, implementing those policies, which I think is great. They just have so many subways and buses up there to clean, but that's something that we can dial down to our local level, too. We spoke with someone from the city yesterday about their concerns. There hasn't been anything, if there are closures, it will probably be in consult with the governor, or more so, really, the state health officer, who is Dr. Jimmy Lafree. He'll kind of make those recommendations if they do come down. But it seems, overall, that these aren't being recommended unless there's a really, if there's a positive case in your region, or close to where you're at, and then we're kind of starting to see some alterations on that front. We are having cases close to home. So the EPA released a list of disinfectants approved to fight to get rid of this COVID-19 on surfaces. Most of them are Clorox, Lysol, but there are greater than 300 products. They're saying this virus isn't so hardy, and they have a long list of all of them to use. They're really not approving anything home cleaners like vinegar and such like that. So these companies had to demonstrate their products are effective against viruses that are even harder to kill than the novel coronavirus. They also noted that any products without an EPA registration number haven't been reviewed by the agency. And you want to pay attention to the directions for the use of these products, especially how long it says to sit on the surface to be effective. And that is essentially it. There's my contact information if you have any questions or anything. Further questions? Do y'all have any questions right now? Like I said, it's a fluid, evolving situation. Just going back to the basics about social distancing, covering the cough, treat it like another severe viral illness, like respiratory spread. So, any questions? So, one of the things I forgot to mention is that Rebecca is an LSUA.
Class of 2000, 20 years
ago. Show my age. But we'll be hanging around just a little bit in case somebody thinks of a question happens.
Yes,
that's all right there. So Dr. Kite is going to speak in a minute, but we also have, just to kind of give you an idea of what you, if you're getting information, where is it important to read it? And Daniel Manuel is our safety officer on campus, and he, if you see an email from him, then it's probably a good idea to read it and not delete it, or to actually take the time to read it just in case there's some information that we need to know. And he's going to hang around too and be able to answer questions about university policies and things like that afterwards if any of you have questions. If anybody has questions, we'll try and grab them all at the end. Thank you very much. It's very informative, I thought it's very important. So Dr. Kite, like I said earlier, is one of our virologists on campus and is very excited to present about the coronavirus. It only took me 2 days to convince him that he needed to do this, but I'm so happy that he agreed.
Try to go over basic background about I know most of us don't really differentiate bacteria, virus, and other bugs, but it's good to have basic background of virus. And what is coronavirus? And there are numerous versions of coronavirus, which most of us have infected or exposed to before. But the recent evolving variants are very pathogenic, and they are emerging viruses. And where did we identify the recent COVID one now, and how the transmission works? And I'll go over the transmission pattern globally, as well as how it looks in the USA, and what are the key important aspects of controlling these viruses, especially these viruses associated to the healthcare system, and how we can contain the transmission that uses hospitals, nursing homes, and so on, and the impact of the disease transmission model, which is helping the virus to be distributed all around the world. And I'll try to see what are the contributing factors for the emerging virus. And it's good to have a whole picture of the information. And what that the clinical symptoms look like, and how we feel the tests that we had in the Jefferson Parish yesterday, and how can we prevent, and who is at risk, and do we have any treatment options, vaccine options, and so on. And this is just looks like a content of a book, but would touch most of the basic things about these virus. Just to start with, I want to just tell you that every day we just breathe and inhale millions of viral particles, and we live in the ocean of virus, and we eat every day, breathe billions of viral particles, and even we carry viral gene in our genes, and they are very smart, and viruses can infect everything. As you can see, they can infect bacteria, insects, birds, cows, worms, dogs, snakes. So they are complicated as normal parasites. Unless they get a host, they cannot continue their life. So they infect everything. So just one important thing that you may have to remember. Viruses are very smart. They cannot help themselves to multiply, but they use our cellular machinery to duplicate themselves. For example, a single paper you just can multiply a million times. Exactly. Viruses, they incorporate their genes in our genes, and they duplicate themselves using our cells. That is the important nature of these viruses. And as I said, we live in the oceans of viruses. And if we take just 1 liter of water, the sea, or coastal seawater, and count the number of viral particles, then you count more number of viral particles than the population of human beings on this planet. And you can see the abundance of the virus around us. Most people think that here is the most abundant, but you can see 94% compared to here and other small creatures. So viruses are just part of our life, and we are raising it, inhaling it, and eating virus every day. So what is virus? As I said, viruses are infectious. They have to infect something to survive and to continue. And they are obligated as cellular parasites because they are incomplete creatures. They cannot do anything. They cannot make energy for themselves. They need other organisms. They hijack our cellular machinery to multiply, to reproduce themselves. So they are obligated as cellular parasites. And they only have genetic elements like RNA or DNA. And that's all. And the protein part, and they are just particles like smart, unless they get some organism to detect. And most of you will be surprised. Our virus is alive. Yes, no, maybe somewhere in between. And I have asked this question several times before. And most of my students say yes. But the answer is somewhere in between. Because these viruses behave like living only when they are in our cells. But whenever they are out of our cells, they are like near living. Okay, so they are not completely living and not completely dead. That much is enough for what is coronavirus? And just the name itself came from what the virus looks like. As you can see, the virus has a crown-like glycoprotein, sugar and protein complex. It's on the surface of the viral particle, and therefore it's called coronavirus, based on the structure of the viral particle. And this virus is involved. As I said, these viruses cannot make anything for themselves, but during shedding of the host cell, they steal the host plasma membrane, and therefore they are enveloped. And the type of genetic element they have is RNA. Viruses can be RNA or DNA. They can never be both RNA and DNA. So coronavirus is RNA virus enveloped virus. And we have several versions of coronavirus. And the first coronavirus that contained human was detected in the 1960s. And we have four main subgroups of coronavirus. These are alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. And the first three are known to infect human. Alpha, beta, and gamma. And especially the recent, the newest version of coronavirus is beta coronavirus. And we have seven common coronaviruses so far known to infect human and other animals. The first four, 229E, can infect bats, camels, and human, especially in 1800s, which causes common cold. And we have OC43, that's a beta coronavirus, that's known to infect cows and cause common cold. And it's known to bovine coronavirus because mostly it infects cattle. And the NH63, the recent one, think bats, puma, those identified in Netherlands in 2004. And it's very common in young children. And Hong Kong, U1, that's a beta coronavirus, Hong Kong version, that was identified in 2005. And we have the recent, the virus is evolving, and we have now three newest version of coronavirus. And these three are the most serious viruses. They are very pathogenic and cause very serious illnesses. And the first one was the SARS that was identified in China in 2003-04, and was gave pandemic was a very big issue during that time. And ultimately it was contained. And we had another one. 2012, again in Asia, Middle East, Saudi Arabia, and that was called MERS coronavirus, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, and that again had similar pathogenesis and severity. And now we have the newest variant that we had just last December, and that's what we call COVID-19. And as you can see, these virus is evolving. See from earliest years, see how it's evolving and changing. And now we have the newest version of virus that still detect human. And if you look at the taxonomic relationship of the whole family of these viruses, you can see the video group, coronavirus, and we have the coronavirus group, which involves the alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. These three are the most pathogenic to human. And now we have the other strain that is, again, most pathogenic. So the bias is just changing every 3 or 5 years. So that is amazing evolution that we can see. And this new coronavirus was named by WHO on February 11th, and it's just now known as COVID-19. And that was derived from the coronavirus disease that was emerging in 2019. So this virus is clearly an emerging infectious disease, because it's caused by a unique beta coronavirus that we have never seen before. It's a new version, increasing the incidence, and potentially it's continuing to infect a new cause of more fatalities. So it can be considered as one of the most emerging infectious diseases of our times. And a brief biology of this enveloped RNA-positive virus. You can see during infection, it just attaches itself to our cells, and then we get entry, penetrate our cells, and then it will come out of its cover, uncoating, and then it will just use the cellular machinery to multiply itself, replication, and makes copies of capsids, genetic elements, and start assembling. And ultimately, it will start shedding off the cell after maturation. And you can see these virus not make its own envelope, but leaves the cell, it will steal the host cellular plasma membrane, and therefore that can also be very helpful for the virus to evade the host immune system. That is why it makes a very serious illness, because it can escape the surveillance of our immunity. And that's a very strategic kind of evasion for most viruses, including the HIV. So, as you can see, the virus can invade our tissues, as the mucosal cell, and the virus is just not invading the cell. And continue like that, and ultimately we see massive destruction of vital organs, especially our lungs. For example, these were the kids from China, 41 years old woman. She came she visited her a doctor, and that was because she had really high fever, and the doctors checked using RT-PCR, and they confirmed that it's COVID-19. And you can see right before the clinical symptoms come, it causes massive destruction. And if this person is moving around, potentially transmitting the disease clearly. And how the identification and transmission of COVID-19 looks. It started in China, where that was December 31st, first pneumonia case of unknown cause was detected in Wuhan City. China. And then this city is the most busy city, has over 11 million residents, but, very attractive for international students, scientists, and business community, and therefore that helped the virus to jump to the rest of the world. Now we have, by February 22, we had over 32 nations confirming the case. And US, we had 40 on February 22. And then the transmission in US continued. The first US coronavirus case of unknown origin detected in California. And remember, we have 2 Air Force stations where they evacuated victims from China, where that was in California and Texas. And I could just think that. That transmission could have some connection with that. And second case on February 28, again in California, unknown origin of the viral infection was confirmed. And then we had a third case, again unknown origin in Washington. And then we had the first fatality in Washington State. And that clearly showed that the virus is aggressively transmitting in the community. And January 29th, I took this picture, and you can see we had about 22 cases in U.S., only one fatality, that was in Washington again. We had the virus confirmed in 7 states, and then 2 days ago, I revised my picture, and now we can see in more than 19 states, and we had over 364 cases in 11 days. That's amazing and highly accelerated transmission. And today, I just looked again, and I had more information, more confirming cases, more than 35 states in 19 days. And the first confirmed case in Jefferson Parish, Louisiana. And the samples are, as she mentioned, sent to be in Atlanta, and they will confirm whether that is a true infection or maybe something else. And if you look at the global picture, now we are almost on every continent we have for COVID-19. And I just try to make this summary. USA, today we have 726 cases and 27 lives passed. And we have 2 serious cases, 2 critical cases. China, where the virus has originated, very starting now. And globally, you can see how it is just speeding up. And as I said, we have 1 case so far. And I just hear that Italy, a country of 60 million people, are in lockdown, completely shut down everything. Because they just recently, the last 2-3 days, they had 9,712 cases and over 660 fatalities. That's amazing and very scary, because the virus is just very aggressive in Italy, in South Korea, there are many parts of Asia countries, including China, where the virus originated. So, how COVID-19 is transmitted? How is spreading? There are 3 major ways of transmission. The first transmission is direct transmission. The second one is indirect. And we have the third transmission mechanism, that's droplet transmission. And what are these mechanisms? And I do suspect these viruses can be transmitted through fecal oral routes too, because clinically we see carrier, which means virus shed in the intestine as well. So just keep in mind that these are the major transmission mechanisms for most infectious diseases. We say direct transmission is just contact between individuals, person to person. Indirect, we touch object and somebody touch it, then that is an indirect transmission. We open the door, that's indirect transmission. Somebody who might have exposed to the virus, touch something, and another person touch, that would be the indirect transmission. Droplet transmission, if I sneeze from here, I'll just release numerous particles, viral particles, that can infect over 1,000 individuals. So, make sure that she pointed at least 6 feet away from infected or people who are at risk of getting exposed to the virus. So when I say direct transmission, it's just like among family, we have very close contact with our children, with our family members, and in the hospital. That's where the virus is receiving transmitted in the patient. Just work with our patients, touch each other, we share movements, and that is where we get direct transmission of the virus. Indirectly, we share movements, especially in labs, hospitals, clinics, nursing homes, and schools, and out our door handles, keyboards, chairs, tables. We touch somebody who might have exposed to the virus, touch, then that would be the indirect transmission mechanism for the virus. And droplet transmission, somebody sneeze, cough, released numerous articles around to see, then get a chance to get into our proposal tissues, you can easily get linked. So the key information here, the healthcare-associated infection, where we have a compromised individual, infectious organisms, and the vehicle of moving stuff, sharing stuff together, that's where the virus is aggressive. Nursing homes, you can see we have organisms coming to the hospital, clinic, nursing homes. We have individuals who are compromised, sick, they come for virus purposes, and therefore the virus can get those individuals. And the chain of transmission, nurses touch different individuals, their patients, they may forget washing their hands or using other ways of prevention, but they can just use the virus to be transmitted among their clients. And we have another major issue here. We have the so-called the disease triangle model, where you have the host, the virus, and the environment that helps the transmission. Clearly, you can see that might have happened for coronavirus, because we just appeared in server and receiving the virus is distributed around the world. So we can see that COVID-19 is contagious, very aggressively transmitting among communities, and this happens when the patient is highly symptomatic, which means the sickest stage. That is where the virus is transmitted. But we do have cases where the virus can be transmitted even if the host is not really sick, and we see clinical symptoms. This is the best example. The person visited the hospital when she saw that she had abnormal fever, and she was confirmed to be positive for COVID-19. And this person was just walking before she visited the hospital. Therefore, she had been transmitting the virus around. And that is the very scary nature of this virus. So, additional information. Most of these coronaviruses are infecting other organisms. For example, NH63 was infecting bats, and SARS, the recent one, again in Asia, confirmed in bats and cats, and the recent MERS, those infecting bats as well as common, and we had the mobile coronavirus, OC43, and the newest version. We don't have clear data about this, but there are suspected cases, could be dogs or snakes and bats, and we suspect that the version that we have might have evolved from snake and bats. And that's why it's very aggressive and very pathogenic. So we need to work a lot to figure out where this virus came from and how it evolved. So this virus is efficiently and sustainably transmitted around the world, including China. And in the U.S., originally it was limited to person to person, but now we see very growing movement. And as I said, we just hear from Jefferson Parish of Louisiana, which is not confirmed yet, and we have a lot of questions about this, because we don't know how it transmits and how severe it is, because we see very huge difference between the elderly individuals and the children. And therefore, a lot, there are still a lot to learn about the virus. And we don't know how long it can survive on surfaces, and so many questions. So, what are the contributing factors for COVID-19? Clearly, modern transportation. That is what we see, how the virus continues to be transmitted around the world. And the way we handle animals, camels, dogs, snakes, bats, these are potential reservoir organisms. And we do see some issues with public health facilities as well, and politics, WHO, they should have notified the warrant when these cases was detected right away. And, because tick-borne infections should be public immediately. And how can we prevent their transmission? She mentioned most of the mechanisms of prevention. Avoid close contact with infected people. Avoid itching your eyes, mouth, nose, and stay home if you are sick. Cover your cough, sneezing, and clean and disinfect everything that you share with other people. And use face mask if you think you are exposed or infected, and continuously wash your hands. Open the door, if you share something, it's very important to wash our hands. And washing hands can stop the transmission of so many infectious organisms. And we can use alcohol-based sanitizers, 60 to 90%, that can take out these viruses. I mentioned about the nature of the virus. It's an envelope virus, very weak. We can kill it very easily. We don't really need very special chemical to avoid the transmission. How long the virus can stay on surfaces, we don't know. There's no clear data telling us that the virus can stay for 1 hour, 3 hours, 6 hours, 12 hours. There are speculations, but so far there's no clear data. But we know something about these viruses. These viruses enveloped, and most enveloped viruses are very weak viruses, and they cannot stay very long. Okay? They need post-cell to survive. They will die after a few hours. I would say 3 hours to 12 hours, maybe 24 hours they can stay. But there are some speculations, which is not really scientific to believe. They say that it can stay up to 16 days, but I don't know how. How long is the average incubation period for COVID-19? The average incubation period is just a week, 5 to 6 days. But it depends on how strong we are. If we are very strong, the clinical symptoms may stay up to 14 days. But if we are very weak, have underlying some health issues, then it can come within a day or so. Okay? So the entire incubation period ranges for 1 day for very weak individuals who stay up to 40 days, or some of us may be completely protected, including children. So, what are the clinical symptoms and how can we test these viruses? The clinical symptoms are very common. You know, flu, so common cold, and other respiratory infections. Runny nose, fever, coughs, sore throat, diarrhea, breathing. And in the worst case, we have pneumonia. And as I said before, these are common for other infections, like flu and other upper respiratory infections. So we need to confirm that the case is COVID-19. So we need other mechanisms of information. And that can be done at CDC, and they use PCR or RT-PCR. We can use other molecular methods or serological methods to prove that the infection is COVID-19. Now, do we have any treatment? There is no specific antiviral treatment against COVID-19. And as you all know, antibiotics does not work against any virus, and COVID-19 is not different as well. And the only thing we can do for infected people, we can give them supportive care. We can keep their vital organs function. And we can give them humidifiers, steamy shower, other salt, ratty, thoughts, and plenty of rest. This could be a very helpful supportive care. We don't have a specific antibiotic or drug, whatever. We have any vaccine. At this point, we have no specific vaccine against COVID-19. But we have companies promising to make some in weeks, months, maybe years. But I do suspect that we'll have a vaccine within a year or so, because it shouldn't work. The traditional vaccine will not work against these viruses. But we need need a basic molecular and immunological research to determine an effective vaccine against COVID-19. And we need a universal coronavirus vaccine, because this virus is clearly evolving. And therefore, unless we get something that can work against a wide variety of the family, it would not be a good vaccine. So we need to do more research to get one. At this point, the major and the very critical approach to contain these viruses is isolating infected individuals and setting up landmarks if somebody is exposed or infected, and identifying people who might have exposed to those people at risk. And who is at risk for contracting the virus? Medical professionals are the most at risk. And people who live in China or recently traveled to China or might have in contact with somebody who might travel to China or came from China or might have contacted person who was exposed. And especially elderly and those with underlying pre-existing conditions like diabetes and all she mentioned are at risk. Luckily, our children are safer in this case because the infection is very mild in children. At this point, we don't have to panic, but we have to be very careful how we deal with the control of virus. And I say we don't have to panic because this virus is not different from what we saw before. We have seen SARS, it was contained in MERS, of in Saudi Arabia, that was contained, and therefore we can be confident that COVID-19 will be controlled as well. But we have to be very careful how we apply the important public health measures, which is very important. And we have to be knowledgeable about how the virus is transmitted, direct encounters, in contact with infected people. Even if they are on farm, we should keep them isolated. Indirect mechanisms, just droplet mechanisms, and maybe other kinds of transmission. And we have to remember, washing our hands is very critical. We can stop the transmission of several infectious, emerging infections by just washing our hands. And that will stop right there, because these are very broad information. We can just talk many aspects of the virus, but I'll just stop here. And, if you have any questions, you can call.
I have quite a question. So it didn't.